Dr. Sridhar, can you hear me?
Yes, yes, I can.
Okay, I think we can start our session. So welcome to our 11th session. I'm really sorry for making you wait for 12 minutes. So today we are having a session by Dr. Sridhar. No, no.
Yeah, I can share it from here.
We can have it for around 40 to 45 minutes, followed by 15 minutes of discussion. By 4 o'clock, we can have our case presentation, followed by its discussion. We can wind up our session by 4:30. Thank you all for joining in. Over to Dr. Sridevi. I hope she is a very familiar face for us. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Rajan. The PowerPoint is visible, right?
Yes, yes, it is.
Okay. So we'll quickly start to the topic. So we all know how important respiratory symptom is because it is one of the vital signs. When you go to the patient to take vital signs every now and then, this is one thing that you notice every time, right? Along with the BP, pulse, temperature, respiration is very, very important. And we all think that we all think that when it comes to breathlessness, we think about cancer primarily. So I will tell you two examples of patient referrals that I received, which I felt which I was personally involved in their care to make the scenario from which the patients come. So there was a 50-year-old female and she had two daughters. One got married and the other was studying, and her husband was a coolie worker. Suddenly she started developing shortness of breath in 2 weeks, and she consulted a nearby hospital. And she didn't have any asthma or she was not hypertensive. They took an X-ray and they found out that there is a malignancy, and that was secondaries from unknown primary. It was just in a period of 2 weeks. And she was suddenly, she started developing severe breathlessness, and she was admitted in a respiratory intensive care unit. She was on continuous oxygen. And then the respiratory medicine people thought that, okay, there is nothing from our side because it's such a huge lesion in the lung. They referred to palliative care, or they told, okay, you go home, arrange your own oxygen and go. So this is one type of patients that we get very often that you all will be familiar, end stage cancer. This is another male who came to our OP who got referred from the respiratory medicine. He had a 2.5 years old child. He was working in Gulf for many years. Suddenly he started developing shortness of breath, and it aggravated in between. And then he came back home from Gulf. He came to medical college, went in as an emergency, put on continuous oxygen, and then they investigated. It came out as asbestosis. So it's not a cancer, it is asbestosis, and the whole lung is full of asbestos materials. There was no bronchioles, nothing was visible, and he could not breathe. Even with oxygen, he was struggling for breath, and he was referred to palliative care to manage breathlessness. So these will be the category of patients that we'll be seeing in palliative care. Patients who has undergone routine treatment, not relieved from breathlessness. So coming to breathlessness. So what do you mean by normal breath? Normal breath is just a, we think that it's just a physiological process. We take in air, breathe out, breathe in. But when it comes to the emotional side, breath is something, it speaks a lot. When you are sad, your breath changes. When you are excited, when you see something really exciting, your breath changes. When someone asks you some question and you feel really sad, you just give a sigh. That is also breath. So breath also speaks a lot of things. When you ask someone how is your day, then patient may just give you a breath. That itself tell you that the day was not good. So it's not just a breath. It's all about psychological and spiritual things that they are giving you, hints. So we should be able to pick up on those hints. Usually the breathing is involuntary. Do we ever know that when we are breathing in and breathing out? No, right? Even when you are talking, when you are listening to session, you are just breathing. And we just take, okay, this is something very routine. And there is a definition for breathlessness. You don't need to learn the definition, but I have highlighted red color, a subjective experience. It is a subjective experience like in pain. Pain, we say it's a subjective experience. It's all about what the patient feels. So breathlessness is also a subjective experience of breathing discomfort. So I'll tell you how common it is. When I say prevalence, it means how common breathlessness is in palliative care. In lung cancer, we can see 75 to 87% of patients will have breathlessness. And when you take away cancer and other illness like COPD, heart disease, there were 50% of patients who were breathless. And many of the patients at the time of death, that is 65% of patients at the time of death, will experience breathlessness. That we very commonly see, right? Patients, when they are dying, their breathing pattern changes. They become breathless, irrespective of what their diagnosis is. Whether it is cancer, whether it is non-cancer, their breathing pattern changes when they are dying. So there are two patterns of breathlessness. We say about pain, continuous pain, breakthrough pain. Like that, there are two patterns for breathlessness. One is a continuous breathlessness. Background may there will be difficulty in breathing. In between, there will be acute exacerbations of breathing problems. So the team from Dilasa will be very familiar with the two breathing patterns, because we just now managed a patient with breathlessness, and he had a continuous dyspnea all through the time, and in between there were episodes of breakthrough breathlessness. So that is a common pattern of breathlessness. So in terms of cancer, it's mostly seen during end of life, but in terms of non-cancer, when the person is having heart failure or COPD, they'll be having breathlessness for a long period of time. So that person where you have treated had breathlessness for 20 or 30 years, but it exaggerated when he had a cancer. So that is a regular pattern of breathlessness. So these are the three qualities of breathlessness. Three types they can explain to you. One is air hunger, that is unsatisfied inspiration. I'm not satisfied with when I inspire, I don't feel like I'm getting enough breath. That is one thing. Second thing would be, I have to put lot of work to get a normal breath. I have to put a lot of muscles into work so that I get a normal breath. And some people will tell you, I have tightness of breath, tightness of chest tightness when I'm trying to breathe. So three different types they explain if you ask. We never ask, we just document breathlessness. So it is very important to ask them what kind of breathlessness they have. So first is air hunger. So this is how patients tell you, I cannot get enough air. My breaths did not satisfy me. And I'm starving for air. Even if I'm breathing, I cannot get enough water.
Doctor, you can continue.
Yeah. So that is air hunger. That is, I'm not getting enough air to breathe in. This can happen when the person is having hypoxia, or when a small example would be when you exercise for some time, even if you breathe, you feel like you are not getting enough air when you exercise aggressively. So that is what patients explain you, air hunger. I'm not going into the respiratory center details because that's not needed for you. Second is work or effort. That means I have to put a lot of effort on my muscles so that I can breathe. It's an effort to breathe. Or my breathing requires more work. The patient will be tired after breathing. So it's usually associated with chest tightness. They say, I feel the chest is very tight. They try to open up their clothes, loosen their clothes every time. And there is a close interaction between the breathlessness pathway and with the pain pathway. So there is a close interaction. So sometimes patient will feel pain when they have dyspnea. So I'm not going into the neural or the receptor-based pathophysiology. This is a simple practical pathophysiology. That is, when there is a breathlessness, the person will be anxious because they see death in front of them. When they are breathless, they feel that I am going to die. I'm going to die without proper oxygen getting into me. So when they are scared, there is more anxiety, then there is more dyspnea. So when there is more dyspnea, again the patient becomes anxious because he thinks that he is going to die. So it's a vicious cycle. Once you give a break to the dyspnea, everything will be reversed. So this is a simple practical pathophysiology that you need to understand. So important is to decrease the anxiety, decrease the breathlessness, and decrease the fear of dying. So what are the causes for breathlessness? It can be due to the primary lung cancer or maybe due to the metastatic cancer. It can be due to lymphatic infiltration by the tumor. It can be due to malignant pleural effusion. So the person may not have CA lung. The cancer will be somewhere else, but he will be having a pleural effusion. That can cause breathlessness. There can be obstruction in the trachea. Some tumor mass from the esophagus invading into the respiratory system can cause breathlessness. Many treatments like surgery, radiation, and chemotherapy can also lead to dyspnea. apart from cancer. So you have a cancer patient coming to you, but he also has a cardiac failure, infection, COPD, pneumothorax. So when you have a cancer in the lung, the cancer can always get into the pleural space and can give rise to pneumothorax. So sudden pneumothorax or pleural effusion. This can also cause breathlessness. So it's not just about tumor mass, it's always about the other illness also when we say breathlessness. So these are the other things which can cause. When someone is in pain or anxious, they feel breathless. Even when we are going for an exam, when we are anxious, we feel really breathless. So these are another reasons for being breathless. When you have a very low HB, goes to 8 or 7, you feel really breathless. So these are other causes of breathlessness. So how will you assess breathlessness? It is same as that of pain assessment. It is very similar to pain. You have to ask everything about breathlessness. A good history taking should include what is the quality of dyspnea. We mentioned three types of qualities. Remember, air hunger, work or effort, and chest tightness. So you have to ask what kind of dyspnea they have. Is it constant or is it episodic? It is coming and going, like intermittent. What is the intensity? So we can tell them to score the breathlessness in a scale that we tell as in pain. What is the impact on patients' life? The patients will be telling, I cannot walk to the toilet. I cannot eat properly because of this. I cannot laugh or cry. I cannot talk. So ask them how it is going to impact. And what is the concern of patient and caregivers? What is bothering them the most? It is very similar to pain history taking, nothing different. It is very, very similar to pain. So what are the physical signs? You can notice when the patient is sitting. Just check whether the trachea is central, whether when he is breathing, whether the nasal flaring is there. Is he using the accessory muscles for respiration? What is the respiratory rate? And you can gently percuss and see whether there is any fluid inside the lungs. And always, I don't think nurses should not auscultate. It's not just doctor's duty to auscultate. As I told in the GI symptoms also, you should always auscultate for the normal findings among yourselves so that when a patient comes, you will understand what abnormal means. So please start auscultating. Raju, can you mute the other?
Yes, ma'am, we can.
So it's always important to auscultate from your side, because when you go for home care or any other setting alone, you should be able to understand air entry, ronchi, Krebs, basic things. So what are the investigations to be sent? We need to send for investigations only when it is needed. A person who is severely breathless, going to die, what is the point in sending him for X-ray? So investigations only if it is going to help you in management. As I said, severity of dyspnea, we can NRSS numerical rating scale, the 0 to 10 scale that we use in pain. Ask the patient to score the severity of breathlessness. Ask what are the precipitating factors. Some people may say walking. While walking, I have more breathlessness. While talking or eating. So what is the thing that increases the breathlessness? What is the trajectory? This is the same thing I mentioned in the last slide. What is the trajectory of breathlessness? Is it continuous or is it episodic? Ask for past medical history. This is same as any other symptom. COPD, asthma, or is there any tuberculosis history? Renal failure, HIV. So many things can contribute to breathlessness. Ask about the occupation. I thought asbestosis and silicosis are very rare in our setting, but there are people who report with asbestosis and silicosis. If they are taking beta blockers, the antihypertensive drugs, they can have dyspnea. And look for sputum, hemoptysis, wheeze or stridor, pleuritic chest pain. Is there any other thing associated with that? So physical examination, as I told, percuss, listen to their chest, listen to their chest, what it hears. And if needed, we can send for ultrasound or chest X-ray. Check for anemia, because sometimes it is just an anemia causing dyspnea. So it's important to go through the basic minimum investigations. If we can correct the anemia, it will be better. So these are the important points to consider. Consider when you are sending for a test, when you are sending for a blood test or an X-ray, what are the inconvenience and the risk of investigation? And is it going to benefit? how long the patient is going to live. If the patient is going to die within few days, what is the point in getting an ambulance, transporting and sending for x-ray, sending for blood test? That is not needed. So depending on the patient's life expectancy, we can decide what investigations to be done. So whatever decisions we make, we should make with the family and the patient. Ask them their convenience, their wishes, and whether they are able to go for investigation. So I don't know whether you remember, these are the basic principles of symptom management, which is EMA. Evaluation, examination, monitoring, management, monitoring, and attention to detail. This applies to everything. Whatever symptom you see in palliative care, this is a basic principle. So these are some of the studies. You don't need to read the whole study, but I'll tell you, sometimes patients will tell you, I am not breathless. But looking at the patient, we feel that patient is breathless. So what the patient feels, what the doctor recognizes, can be different. So this is an example. They did a study in Australia. So it was 33 patients came with breathlessness to a hospital. So there were 33 patients. But what happened was that one patient did not have dyspnea. He was not breathless. But the doctors thought that that he has breathlessness. Just a moment, Raju.
Okay, ma'am.
So of the 33 patients, doctors thought this patient has breathlessness, but the patient told, I am comfortable. So what we see may be different from what the patient is feeling. So it's always important to ask. We may misunderstand that as breathlessness. So infection, pneumothorax, I told these are the another reasons for having breathlessness. Infection, COPD, pneumothorax, or pleural or pericardial infection. All these are correctable. If there is an infection, patient will be breathless. Pneumonia, patient will be breathless. So we can give a good course of antibiotics. Pneumothorax, patient will be breathless. If there is a pleural effusion, when you do the pleural tapping, there will be more space for the lungs to expand so they can breathe easily. So wherever we can correct these things, we should correct. Then you move on to the next step. There are other correctable factors, like sometimes patients with CA breast or CA lung will have a chemotherapy. That chemotherapy itself can cause breathlessness. And sometimes they may have lymph nodes compressing the trachea. So we can give a radiation so that it will reduce the volume and can help in treating breathlessness. So whatever the basic idea is, that whatever things are correctable, correct them. So I'll come to the non-pharmacological management. I know that you can notice I have written fan. So this is not that I'm telling that fan is helpful. Small handheld fan, very small handheld fan, battery driven fancy fans. If you keep the fan on the side of the face, it can help in breathlessness. And we can tell them to move the coat to the near the windows, proper ventilation, chest physiotherapy, and some of the exercises can be beneficial. These are the things which is non-pharmacological management. Fan is really important because it's proven. There are a lot of studies in which patients are told that on the side of the face, if you put a handheld fan, patients will feel better when they are breathless. So there are many treatments for breathlessness in palliative care. It's not just bronchodilators or anything. The treatment varies in palliative care. So I'll come to one by one. First will be oxygen and opioids. So you might have seen in all the setting, people use a lot of oxygen. The moment patient comes in, we fit the oxygen mask or a prongs. The moment you see breathlessness, you just fit in the oxygen. And there is a use for oxygen. I am not telling oxygen is not useful or it is useless. There are situations where oxygen can be helpful, but not for all. In terminal illness, there is no correlation with dyspnea and hypoxia. The patient may be breathless, but the oxygen saturation can be normal. So there is a big study. This presentation was meant for doctors because doctors always use a lot of oxygen when patient comes in. So there is an evidence showing that there is no benefit from oxygen when you compare oxygen and the room air. So some of the patients, 239 patients, they divide it into two groups. One group of patients received oxygen, one group of patients received room air, no oxygen, just room air. So what happened? Both had similar experience. So it has been shown that oxygen is not useful when it comes to terminal illness. Especially when they have life-limiting or a progressive illness, the effectiveness of oxygen for relieving breathlessness is similar to air. So it's okay, you give the room air, not give oxygen. Regarding opioids, we do use, when you say morphine, it's not just for pain management. We can use opioids even for breathlessness. So during pain session, they might have told about opioid receptors. So opioid receptors are there everywhere. It is there in the periphery, it is there in the brain, it is there in the spinal cord. We can give carefully titrated doses of opioids for treating breathlessness. Sometimes we feel scared because we have learned that morphine can cause respiratory depression. But if you are titrating the dose really carefully, it can help. It can be really helpful in treating this need. So in palliative care, opioids are the mainstay of drug therapy for breathlessness. And there is no reported respiratory depression. And just that we have to check the renal function or hepatic function. That's it. And we have to check the respiratory rate, the availability of nursing monitoring. So when I use opioids, I prefer to have a nurse who can check the respiratory rate, whether it is going down or going really down. So oxygen, oxygen is like any other drug. We think oxygen is something very, really normal, casual. Oxygen means it is there that we breathe oxygen. So why don't we give it through the cylinder to the patient? It's not normal. It's a drug. If it is normal, we can always carry oxygen cylinder with us, right? Why we are not carrying? It's a drug. It's a therapy. So when you are doing a therapy, you have to think whether this is going to benefit. If the patient is telling that I need oxygen, try to give it through nasal cannula, not through the mask. Why? I need to hear from you. I know that we are sitting in two different rooms in the same building, but I want to hear from you why I am telling nasal cannula. I do tell that to you. Change the mask and put in the cannula. Why?
Sister Neeraja, Sister Janaki, Dilasa team, come on. Yes, Sister Janaki.
I don't want any prompting from behind. I have to hear it from nurses. Why I'm telling to remove the mask and put in the prompts?
Mom, patient is COPD, no? So that's why 5 to 6 liters aggressive and flow is there, mom. Yeah. So lung capacity is not acceptable. That is the one reason.
So you need telling you need more oxygen, so which cannot be delivered by mask.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Any other reason? Or not COPD. Patient just needs 2 liters per 2 liters per minute.
That's a thing.
In nasal prongs, oxygen will directly deliver to lungs. Or when we use mask, then it will.
Not exactly. Even the mask, when he inspires, it is going to lungs.
Yes.
So it's a very simple reason. The patient is dying. He wants to talk to the family. How will he talk? What you might the nurses who have worked in a private or any other sector, you might have seen when they want to talk, they remove the mask and talk. They keep removing the mask and talk, right?
Okay. Exactly.
Yeah, they keep removing the mask. How do they talk to the family members? They have many things to talk. And once you put in the oxygen mask, it is really threatening. They feel scared. They really see death in front of them the moment you put in the oxygen mask. I myself have received an oxygen mask for no reason. I felt that I am dying seeing the mask. And whenever I wanted to talk to my family, I was keeping on removing the mask. And patients who are on long-term care at home with oxygen mask, I have seen patients developing ulcers in the area of the mask because they keep the mask constantly. When we talk about ulcers, the sores, the mask area will also give sores. The patients develop ulcers at the area of mask. So nasal cannula, they can talk to the family. They can have it is not that scary. It's just two straws going inside. So they feel more comfortable when they talk. So that is a simple reason. The scientific reason, if you want high flow of air, then you cannot give through mask. Then you have to depend on NIV or even, I don't know how far the prongs can help. You may have to go for the NIV. And thank you for the response, sir, from the other side. This is the effect of opioids. So when you give, I don't want you to read through all these things because this is purely meant for doctors who prescribe opioids. But just understand that when you give opioids, you give opioid and you go and check the SpO2, the SpO2 will not change. So the first thing I want you to understand is that SpO2 is not always the measure for dyspnea the patient is experiencing. The patient's experience is different, your SpO2 is different. So even if you give morphine, the patient will tell you, I am feeling comfortable, but the SpO2 will remain the same. So if you are checking on the SpO2 and giving medication, then morphine is useless. But if you want to treat the patient, if you want to help the patient, then you can use morphine. If you are treating the SpO2 machine, then you cannot use any of these measures. It just keep going down. So one thing I tell everyone when I talk about breathlessness in end of life, especially the oxygen saturation has to come down. No one can die with 100% oxygen saturation, right? Have you ever seen someone dying without breathing pattern changing and SpO2? It has to go down. And there is no use of pushing oxygen back to back or giving bronchodilators like Theraphylline when the patient is breathless. So these are the effect of morphine. Morphine will not treat your SpO2, but it will treat the patient's feeling of breathlessness. The patient will feel reduced perception of dyspnea. It has a central anxiolytic effect. So it will reduce anxiety a little bit, so patient will breathe better. So this is another evidence for, sorry that it is meant for people who generally argue that opioids cannot be used. I know that it is not needed for nurses. But it is good to know that there is a lot of evidence supporting the use of opioids in patients with dyspnea. Use of oxygen and opioids sometimes, or only opioids, has proven to be very effective in terms of dyspnea. And it is in the last line, you can read, oxygen should be seen as a pharmacological agent. It is a drug therapy. And it should not be given based on your intuition that, okay, breathlessness means oxygen. It should not be given on the intuition that it can benefit. It is also a therapy. So these are the morphine doses. You can, if you have sustained release morphine, you can use 10 milligram of sustained release morphine. But we generally use immediate release morphine, the short acting morphine. We start with 2.5 milligram 8th hourly or 6th hourly or even 5 milligram. That if they are already on opioids for pain, you can slightly increase the dose of morphine. Some patients will not have breathlessness continuously, they will have episodic breathlessness. Then give SOS dose whenever they say breathlessness, give a injectable or oral morphine for breathlessness. So, next wonderful drug in breathlessness is steroid because steroids reduce peritumor edema. I don't know whether you guys remember, I told in GI, the gastrointestinal session, that when you give steroid, whenever there is a tumor, around the tumor, there is edema. So when you give steroid, the peritumor edema will be reduced. So that will give some space for the air to get in. So dexamethasone is a really wonderful drug in terms of breathlessness, even in COPD patients. So we usually start with 4 to 12 or up to 16 milligram of dexamethasone as a single daily dose. Benzodiazepine. So we have been talking about oxygen. We have talked about opioids like morphine. The third one was dexamethasone. And the fourth one was benzodiazepines. It comes like zilorazepam or midazolam under this category. So many of the doctors are scared to give benzodiazepines when the patients have breathlessness. But it is shown that, do you remember the first blue picture that I showed? Dyspnea, fear of death and anxiety. So we need to treat the anxiety. Otherwise, the patient will become more breathless. So benzodiazepine is a mainstay of treatment because it treats anxiety. Once you are anxious, a simple example is when you are going for exam, when you become anxious, you feel breathless. So you need something to calm you down, right? So this is an anti-anxiety drug. We can give subcutaneous midazolam because it is a very short-acting drug during last hours or days of life. And we can give SOS doses of midazolam when you have a breakthrough dysphonia. And even lorazepam can also use, but lorazepam is a longer-acting one. So if the patient becomes more drowsy, it's not a good, we cannot control much. Midazolam is really, really short-acting drug. So four drugs we talked about, oxygen, not found to be beneficial in breathlessness when they have advanced illness. Second one was opioids, low dose morphine, start with 2.5 milligram. And the third one was steroid. And the fourth one is benzodiazepine, like mostly midazolam. So this is a small flowchart. And you can see why we talk a lot about breathlessness to nurses. You can see the first column itself is a non-pharmacological management. Handheld fan, teach them how to relax. When they are breathless, they take deep breaths. So they may end up in getting more carbon dioxide in the body. So tell them to take shallow breaths, not hyper, no, they do hyperventilate. So you have to tell them to take shallow breaths. Give them walking aids, support while sitting, eating small meals. So everything can be taught to them. And so that is why you need to know how the non-pharmacological management can help in breathlessness. And then the flowchart goes till there is the patient reaches end of life care. So these are the practice points. Breathlessness is common in chronic, malignant or not. When I say breathlessness, it's not just cancer. It comes in non-cancer also. When you are taking a history, take as though you are taking a pain history. You have to ask for everything when you take history of breathlessness. And non-drug approaches can be useful for some patients in earlier stages of illness. I'm not going through this. I'll just briefly go through a lot, a little bit of symptoms like cough. Cough is mostly seen in cancer and in COPD. And sometimes severe cough can cause severe pain, rib fracture, urinary incontinence, and sometimes sleep disturbance. So what are the complications of cough? Cough can cause physical complications like pain, rib fractures, incontinence, sweating, exhaustion, and sleep disturbance. I'm not going into the phases of cough, just cough in palliative care. Most commonly, tumors can cause cough, involvement of pleura, or aspiration. Aspiration is very, very common in palliative care. So aspiration can also cause cough, which may lead to pneumonia later. And there will be hypersecretion of mucus sometimes associated with cough. I'm not going into the details of all these drugs. I will come to the noisy airway secretions in last hours or days of life because I know that nurses deal this than doctors because you see a lot of patients when they are dying phase. You see for a long period of time. So these airway secretions are called death rattles. So death rattle, why death rattle occurs? Have you ever heard people making noise when they die? Loud noise. I hope you might have seen. So that will be the giggling sound of the gargling sound in the throat. So the relatives will tell you he has lot of sputum, lot of lung infection. Then some doctors will start them on antibiotics thinking that the patient has chest infection. So it's really important to understand what a death rattle means. The name itself indicates that the rattle is leading to death. Raju, am I still audible?
Yes, ma'am, you are.
The current went off, so I may have some disconnection for some time. Okay. So death rattle means the vibration of accumulated secretions. When someone is dying, your swallowing is lost, right? They cannot swallow properly. So that will accumulate all your pharyngeal and pulmonary secretions. Patient cannot cough, patient cannot swallow, patient cannot expectorate. So that will pool inside near the throat and that will make that noise while they are dying. So it's not the sputum or the infection causing the noise, it's the secretions which they are unable to expectorate when they are unconscious. So most of the patients, when they die, they will have death rattle. And once the patients start having death rattle, most of them die within 48 hours after the onset of death rattle. So again, to the Dilasa team, you might have noticed the patient had a death rattle few hours before he expired. And we did not do much for death rattle because it's not breathlessness or a sputum. It's the secretions that is pooling in the throat. And the patient died few hours after death. So that typical vibrating loud noise is called a death rattle. The moment you hear death rattle, it is a time to tell the family that there is not much time in front of us. The patient is maybe dying. What can be done for death rattle? Positioning is one thing which we can do. Side lying position and give a nice chest physiotherapy so that the secretions will come out. For some patients, for example, the patient who died, he could not tolerate supine position. We could not make him lie down on the right side lying position. Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Okay. So the positioning can be one thing which we can do. The moment you turn the patient to one side, all the secretions will come out and the breath rattling noise will come out. The main reason for problem with the death rattle is that it has an impact on staff. You all felt the bad, right? The noise came out. Oh, the patient is... everyone feel really bad. The patient is trying to breathe hard. He cannot cough. There is something obstructed in his throat. So we all feel bad. The patient might be going through a lot of difficulty. And sometimes many doctors and nurses will feel that we should do suctioning, right? The moment you hear the noise, you run and go take the suction and put it into the throat. So we feel obliged to take out that secretion and make them feel good. The thing is that the patients will not feel much difficulty with the noisy breathing. It's just about the people like us and the caregivers because they feel their loved one is struggling a lot for them. So the treatment is generally for making them comfortable than the patient. Because patients may not feel that breathless or difficulty when they have the death rattle. So this is a drug that we can use for breathlessness, for the death rattle. Glycopyrrolate, subcut 0.2 microgram to start with. And same glycopyrrolate ampoule, you can break and give it sublingually. There is no sublingual preparation. You can just give the same ampoule, you can break and you can give sublingually. So if the patient is at home, dying, you can give an ampoule and tell them if the noisy secretions are not, just break an ampoule and give the solution under the tongue. We can go up to 0.8 microgram, that is 800 microgram per day, that is glycopyrrolate. This is another complication that we usually see in palliative care, hemoptysis. Because sometimes patient will just expectorate massive amount of blood. Sometimes 300 ml of blood or more than 500 ml, sometimes over 24 hours. So massive hemoptysis is not very uncommon. People just cough out huge amounts of blood. I'm not going into the causes, but management. Sometimes the patients will be on NSAIDs or clopidogrel or aspirin. So if they are on such drugs, blood thinning agents, stop those drugs. We can give oral or intravenous tranexamic acid or oral or systemic ethambutolate. If there is a massive hemoptysis, that is the patient is just bouting a lot of coughing or bouts of this blood, then it is better to sedate the patient. So that he can be stress-free because they are seeing in front of them coughing out plenty of blood. So that is really important. We cover the management of bleeding in palliative care emergencies later. So I'm not going into details, but giving them sedation may be a way to relieve their stress when they have episode, this kind of big episodes of bleeding. And usually we have to support the family a lot. We have to use the dry towel, the dark colored towels, or we have to keep the emergency box ready with the towels and drugs. And the important thing is to reassure the family, because when you are seeing your loved one coughing out plenty of blood, they really feel stressed out. Some people may faint seeing that. It's really important to support the family members when the patient is going. And basically, I prefer to sedate the patient because if I am the patient, I don't want to see me coughing out or vomiting plenty of blood. I just don't want to see. So it's really important to sedate the patient so that they will not see this cholecystitis. So these are the various symptoms that we cover in breathlessness. I know that I rushed a little bit, but I can take up any questions. Is there any question from? I know that you won't ask any question generally, but I'll be happy to answer if you have any questions. Or I can ask you questions. So how will you determine whether the patient want oxygen or not? I told some patient can get benefit, some patient may not be benefited. So how will you determine whether this patient want oxygen or not? The patient is coming to you with breathlessness. Can be anything. Let's take a CL lung. We have treated the pleural effusion. Effusion is out and patient is coming to you. All the correctables are done. And how will you determine whether to keep oxygen?
Sister Janaki, Sister Neeraja, Dilasati.
Ma'am, to decrease the breathlessness, ma'am. To provide yeah. oxygen in the
yeah. So I'm asking, how will you? I told oxygen is not useful. Oxygen is not useful. I was giving a long speech, but how will you determine whether this oxygen is going to benefit or not? You cannot think every patient may not benefit. Nothing like that. So how will you determine whether this patient needs oxygen or not?
Sister Janaki,
we check the. SpO2, ma'am, oxygen saturation is it is maintained or not, whether it is abnormal or first of all we are checking, ma'am.
Okay.
Once the pleural effusion tapping out, ma'am,
yeah,
patient is breathlessness will reduce.
Okay. So I would like to go back to the, should I go back to the slide again or I'll tell you? There is a slide which I told. Oxygen may not be, hypoxia may not be equal to. When you check SpO2, you get the level of oxygen in their blood, right? That may not be equal to patient's breathlessness. I don't remember where it is, sorry. So that was there in one slide. You can check once you get the slide. So the SpO2 may not be equivalent to patient's feeling of breathlessness. Even if you give 100% maintain 100% SpO2, patients may feel breathless. Or sometimes the SpO2 will be 68 or 70, but the patients will tell you, I am not breathless. I'm comfortable in this way. So the important thing in palliative care from the beginning, what we believe is that, believe the patient. If you think that oxygen is going to benefit, I personally do an oxygen trial. It's not that I do, it's a textbook says and it's an evidence-based practice. We do something called an oxygen trial. So we give 2 liters of oxygen for another 10 minutes. I tell the relatives first, I'm not fixing this for a long time. I don't know whether this oxygen is going to help. I don't think personally. Because you imagine there is a cancer in the lung. Whatever oxygen you give in, there should be something inside the lung to take up that oxygen, right? Where are you pushing this oxygen into? It has to reach the blood and it has to have that exchange happen, the blood gas exchange, and it has to reach the lung. Then only the patient will benefit. There's a huge mass of lung, multiple radio-opaque lesions in the lung, which cannot take up oxygen. So in the beginning, one case scenario was about asbestosis. The lung was completely filled with asbestos particles. There was no lung matter for that patient and patient was given oxygen. where this oxygen is going. He cannot inhale, he cannot exhale. And they were pushing oxygen into him. So there is something called an oxygen trial. You give 2 liters of oxygen for another 10 minutes. Ask the patient whether you are feeling comfortable. If he is feeling comfortable, continue oxygen. If the patient is telling there is not much benefit, you discontinue the oxygen. So patients very sensibly answer you. It's not at all difficult. It's not that we don't ask. So I personally don't check the SpO2 because SpO2 in advanced illness have no relationship with the patient's experience of breathlessness. We are treating the patient, not the partial pressure of oxygen. I want patient to be comfortable. I don't want my blood parameters to be 100% good. So I give an oxygen trial, 2 liters over 10 minutes. Ask the patient, are you comfortable? Do you think the oxygen is helping you? Then they say yes or no. If they are saying yes, continue. They are saying no, just discontinue. And this oxygen will keep the airway really dry, which itself can cause loss of discomfort. So it's another therapy. It's not just air you're giving, it's another therapy. So you need to think whether this is going to benefit the patient. Am I clear? Any more question? Maybe one more question we can take up. I know that people don't ask questions generally, but if we have, we can take one more question before we move on.
Ma'am, I suppose there isn't. I think we can move on to a case presentation now. So today's case presentation will be taken by Sister Janaki from Mahatma Gandhi Cancer Hospital. Over to you, Sister.
Hello. Ma'am, can you hear us, ma'am?
Yes, yes, we can.
Good evening to one and all. I am P. Janaki, nursing in charge in Mahatma Gandhi Cancer Hospital from Vizag. Today my case presentation was a 40 years female diagnosed as a CS cervix metastatic and post radiation and post chemotherapy. Presenting complaints. Complaining bleeding per vagina since 15 days, lower abdominal pain since 3 months, reeling sensation, dehydration, numbness and pain left leg, loss of appetite, breathlessness and cough, unable to lie down position. History of illness. Patient is a known case of carcinoma cervix, post surgery and post chemotherapy, post radiotherapy. 30 cycles was done on 26/7/2019. After one year, she again admitted on 26/11/2018 below the complaints. Came with complaints of severe abdominal pain radiating to lower back and left leg. Pain score is 8/10. Vomitings and diarrhea, vertigo. Consult local Tirumala Hospital at Vijayanagaram. Ultrasound abdomen and X-ray taken. Shown to metastatic lung. Tirumala Hospital referred to Mahatma Gandhi Cancer Hospital. Past surgical history. Hysterectomy done 4 years back. One sitting of hemodialysis was done outside the hospital. Examination. She was conscious and oriented. Vitals are stable with oxygen support. Unable to sit due to severe breathlessness. And pain. Pain score. 8/10, severe pain at the lower back radiating to lower limb. Left leg pain increases in sitting position. Vaginal bleeding present. Vaginal bleeding was present. Altered sleeping pattern because of breathlessness and pain. Fetal edema was present. Decreased urine output since 4 days. One sitting of hemodialysis was done, but not improvement in patient condition. Treatment and significant investigations. Routine blood test done. Ultrasound abdomen. Bulky kidney. Mild hepatomegaly with fatty infiltration. Moderate right hydroureteronephrosis. And mild left hydroureteronephrosis. Cystitis changes. Serum creatinine was 5.6 milligrams per deciliter. Treatment. Palliative radiation 2 months ago, 30 cycles was done. Pain management. Tab Verma 20 mg by orally 4 hourly taken. Symptomatic management with blood product PRBC, 1 unit transfusion because of lower hemoglobin. For better care of patient was referred to urologist and gynecologist. Psychosocial aspect. Patient is cooperative for evaluation and treatment. She is married. Husband is very supportive. She has 2 sons and 1 daughter. They are very supportive. Last son age is 21 years. Patient family knows the diagnosis and prognosis. They have own house, lives in Pakka house at Vijayanagar. Counseling done to family members and all the concerns were addressed. Medications. Tapirinam 10 mg oral TAD. Tapantoprazole 40 mg per oral OD. Tapmorphine 10 mg per oral 4th hourly. Tapvertin 16 mg per oral OD. Serum cremaphin 15 ml. Per oral HS. Injection hospumol 1 gram IV TID. Fentanyl patch 50 mics per hour applied on thigh. Right thigh. IV fluids NS 2 points at the rate of 70 ml per hour. O2 inhalation 5 to 6 liters by face mask. SpO2 90 to 96%. Main concerns. Patient main concerns are pain relief, want to sleep in comfortable position. She was concerned about her last son's marriage. She wants to stay in hospital only. She was not interested to go to home. Family concerns, pain management, comfort. Summary, a 40 years old female patient, known case of CA cervix, underwent surgery in our hospital and after the surgery underwent chemotherapy and radiation treatment. 30 cycles was done. After 1 year, again she admitted because of these below complaints. She came with complaints of severe pain in lower abdomen and left leg and vaginal bleeding, breathlessness and cough. All investigations was done. Patient was medically managed and pain and breathlessness also decreased. Pain score came down to 8 by 10 to 3 by 10. Decreased breathlessness. Patient is aware of diagnosis but not aware of prognosis. Family members are very supportive and they knows her prognosis. Discussion points. What other nursing management can be done for the patient? What more we can do for this patient? How to make her sleeping in comfortable position? Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sister, for the patient story. I know that when nurses do these presentations, I really do appreciate it because it takes a lot of effort from your side to go through the history, make the PowerPoint and send it to us. So thank you for coming up with a patient story. So from the Lhasa team, tell me what other nursing management can be done. So today's questions should be answered by them, right, Raju? Because there are only two teams. And they have done this recently, so I don't need to tell them how to do. No, you just tell me how. What else can we do for this patient? There is no right or wrong answer. So just.
So the patient is on 5 to 6 liters of oxygen. So frequent mouth care or the anything for just to lubricate the mouth, it has to be given. Then frequent oral sips.
Go on. Raju, can you show the last slide, the question? So she's talking about the nursing management, because the patient generally with breathlessness will have open mouth breathing. They keep the mouth open and the oral cavity will be dry, and there are chances of candidiasis inside the mouth. So frequent hydration, and especially when she is on oxygen, the oral cavity and the nasal cavity will be really dry. So one important nursing management would be to keep a good oral care. And what else can we do to make this patient? So she cannot lie down at night, and
so patient can take help of the cardiac table, like leaning down of head, leaning like this position.
Any name for that position? Tripod position. Is that name familiar? Tripod position, because they keep the hand like a tripod, leaning towards a cardiac table and keeping their head on their arms or on a pillow. That will increase the lung volume, and they can breathe in a little bit of more air. So the positioning is really, really important. Don't make them to lie down in supine position, or they cannot actually. Good point. So these are the things that nurses can do from their side, the positioning and the oral care part. And Raju, who was the person who presented the...
Mr. Janaki.
Okay. Mr. Janaki, you mentioned that... I'm sorry. Just give me a minute. Okay, so so you were telling the patient did not want to go home, she wants to be in hospital. Is there any reason behind that? Is she scared because she is breathless?
Yes, ma'am, she is breathless, and the doctor said to palliative care in the hospital. She is she wants to only stay at the hospital because of good care and support provided by nursing staff and their spiritual beliefs, ma'am, due to decreases burden on family members and husband.
So one important thing with breathlessness, when it comes to breathlessness, when people say that they don't want to go home, usually the people will be, the patients will be scared, because they'll be given continuous oxygen. And what happens when I go home? So if you remember the patient's story I described in the beginning, that lady did not want to go home because she was completely dependent on oxygen. And the husband, who was a coolie worker, could not arrange for an oxygen cylinder at home because it was pretty expensive. He had to rent an equipment which cost around 1,000 rupees per day, which is much, much higher than his earnings. So she could not go home. They were in the ICU. They were discharged, but they were not willing to go home because they don't have the equipment. Then later on, when she came to palliative care, she was without oxygen, because with the medications we could manage, take out oxygen, and she could go home and be with the family only for a short period of time, but she could do that. So people are scared the moment they keep getting oxygen, and when breathlessness is there, they see death in front of them. So they feel, when I go home, I become so breathless and I may die. here at least sisters are there, they will come and connect oxygen and give some medications. So so that can be another reason for her not going home. That's what I felt. Raju, is that Dr. Anne sitting near you?
Yes, hello.
Oh my God, I saw you sitting in the back. I could not realize that. Oh my God, then I could have asked you.
Well, hello, everybody. I think this is a great case because it illustrates so many reasons that people might be short of breath. Are people understanding my American English okay?
Are you understanding? Can you raise if it is a yes? Raise your hands if it is a yes.
No problem. So, no. Yes, no. Can you unmute her so we can find out what she's saying? Any trouble with my English?
No, no.
Okay, good. So there, she has metastatic disease to her lungs. She also, it looks to me, she's also has kidney disease and we're giving her fluids. Did everybody notice that? That we're giving her 70 cc's an hour of fluids and she doesn't have kidneys that work. So she can't get rid of the fluids. Look at her serum creatinine is 5.6. So she's leaning forward because she's unable to get rid of fluids. My suspicion, without a chest x-ray, is that she probably has some fluid in her lungs. And that's also contributing, and that's why she's deciding to sit up. She can't lie down because she has too much fluid in her lungs. Those are just my thoughts. I might do things a little differently. I know this is a nursing group, but if you felt comfortable with your doctors, you might ask, what about, do we still want to continue the fluids because she's unable to sleep? I also noticed that she was ready to just be comfortable. Her family wanted her to be comfortable. And so we can focus now on her comfort. See, the family wanted comfort and she wanted to be able to sleep in a comfortable position. This is a situation where I think it's okay to stop the fluids and to do the great mouth care that the Delasa Palliative Care Center suggested. So people, far better for us to do good mouth care, but not put fluid in people's veins if it's just gonna travel to the lungs and make people more short of breath. Anyway, that was Dr. Sridevi. I hope I haven't over-talked, but
those
are my thoughts. Those are my thoughts on that. Those things. I understand that not, if you're a nurse, not everything is in your control, but those are the things that I would be worried about.
Yeah, definitely. So I hope everyone understood what Dr. Anne was suggesting.
Right. You can translate it
in Indian English. You have seen her creatinine was very high, so her kidneys are not functioning. If someone's kidneys are not functioning, then whatever fluids are there inside cannot be gone out. It is just accumulating inside the body. Along with that, we are giving fluids. You remember the patients usually when they are admitted here, they ask for fluids. They are not eaten anything from morning. So irrespective of their kidney function or their progressive nature of illness, we just give them some fluid so that the relatives will stop asking you, so stop nagging you, right? Even we feel concerned the patient has not eaten anything. So her kidney functions are really poor, not able to push the fluids out of her body. That is why she might be really breathless. And along with that, we are pushing more fluids. As I mentioned about oxygen, giving fluids is also a medical intervention. It's not just giving fluid, it's a medical intervention. So even for that, we need to think whether this is benefiting the patient or is it harmful for the patient. And if there is, I think the Lasa team mentioned about the fluid somewhere. So if there is a pleural effusion, tapping the fluid will be beneficial because the patient will feel more relaxed. And one more, as Dr. Ann mentioned, there are some places where nurses can actually tell the doctors, why don't we start something like a steroid? Can we start steroid? Can we give a little bit of midazolam? So if we have, if you are working in a place where you can tell the doctor or suggest as a team, then I would consider midazolam or any benzodiazepine for that matter for this lady. Because she seems to be anxious. That may be one reason people tell that I don't want to go home because I may die in pain or I may die breathless. Everyone will be sleeping. Then I cannot reach hospital. So anxiety is one reason. And in that case, benzodiazepines will work like wonders. Once the patient is less anxious, the breathing pattern normally changes a little bit. So that would be one thing which I would like to add from my side. And Sister Janaki, I have a query in the medications, but I know that it is prescribed by doctors. But if you have a chance to look into it, she's been given round-the-clock morphine and fentanyl. So I just did not understand why both of them together. So you can just clarify in a very friendly way with your doctor why just if morphine was SOS for breathlessness, then I would understand. Because
she is complaining pain, ma'am, right leg pain continuously, ma'am. 8/10 is pain score.
Yes.
And to relieve the pain.
That I understood. The pain medication I understood, but these drugs belong to same group. Yes. We have learned about the step ladder. Remember the third step, we have strong opioids, which has morphine and fentanyl.
Okay.
Sometimes people do use both. For example, patient they use fentanyl patch. If the patient is telling in between breakthrough pain or breakthrough dyspnea, we have to give morphine. But this is round the clock morphine with round the clock fentanyl. So just you can just clarify your thoughts whenever you get a chance to talk to the doctor.
Ma'am, morphine was the high dose. Is the patient is a severe breathlessness and drowsy also, ma'am. So high dose is not recommended in pain control is the medicine fentanyl patch in apply on right leg. She is complaining of left leg, ma'am. She is complaining of left leg and creatinine was 5.6. So yeah. High dose is the morphine not recommended.
Yeah, I understood. So you're telling because of decreased renal function, yes, you don't ma'am. Need to give a higher dose. No, I'm telling they have combined both. So just to clarify from my side. And one more thing, just you mentioned, and I would like to clarify. It's the patch on the left leg because the pain is on the left leg. Is that what you mentioned?
Hello?
You mentioned about the patch on the left leg. The pain is on the left leg. Is that the reason why the patch is on the left leg? I thought you just mentioned about the patch on the left leg because the pain was on the left leg, right?
Yes, ma'am.
So
left leg is the means only back of the thigh buttock also means near left leg on the pain.
Yeah.
Only beside the back of on the buttock.
No, yeah. I'm asking. You have put fentanyl patch on the left leg. Is it because that patient's pain is on the left leg?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So that is one thing I would like to convey, that fentanyl patch, you don't need to apply it at the site of pain. Okay. It is a transdermal patch from which the drug gets absorbed transdermally and it is absorbed into the circulation. It will reach everywhere it is wanted. Like pain will be reduced. Okay. So it's not like the mint kind of patch, that menthol patches that you apply directly over the site of pain. It's not needed. Fentanyl patch can be applied anywhere away from the skin, the bony prominences. It need not be on the site of pain. I have seen this very regularly. That's why I suddenly got when you told that left leg and left leg patch. That is not needed. You can place the patch on the arm or the leg if it is convenient. It need not be dependent on the site of pain. It can be placed anywhere away from the bony prominence where there is there are areas where you can put patch, but it is not the area where they have pain.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Is it clear, Sister Janaki?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Yes,
so ma'am. Yesterday only I told the nurses about a patient in the ward had a low backache in the sacral area. And when we went for the rounds next day morning, we asked where is the patch just to check the date and the time where it is put. Because it's a busy hospital, we have to check whether it is time for change. The patient had to get up from the bed, he removed his pants, he removed his trousers and the underclothes, and then he showed low where in the sacral region the fentanyl patch was put. Because the nurses thought the pain is there, we have to put the patch there. So it is not corresponding to the area of pain. It can be put even in the arm. It will be beneficial for the low backache. Okay. So doctors will order the patch. I know you will be the people who put the patch, right? In your hospital.
Sister Janaki.
Ma'am.
Doctors will write the fentanyl, but nurses will be putting the fentanyl patch, right?
No, ma'am. Doctors also put in the fentanyl patch.
Okay, next time you can tell them it's not corresponding to the area of pain. So in the hospital where I was working, the nurses put, we just write the order. The nurses put. So we took them a session, whole day session on fentanyl, how to place it. And I will just take up, I know that it is not related to this topic, but when you place a fentanyl patch, try not to touch the drug delivery surface. People just put it like a sticker. It's not just a sticker. Your skin will absorb fentanyl.
Yes.
So when you put it, don't touch the, it's very clearly mentioned in the cover how to put the patch like a band-aid without touching the drug delivery site. And when you remove also, when you take off the fentanyl patch, fold it inwards. Don't just take it and put it in the dustbin. Because some children, usually the children think that it is just a sticker, and there was a situation where one child just took it and put it on him because he has seen his grandfather putting it. So you have to fold it inwards so that you, because there will be remaining drug in the patch. So once you touch the patch, that will get absorbed to you also. Unless you need fentanyl, just fold it inwards and before disposal. Do you understand when I say inwards?
Inner side, madam, inner side.
Yeah. I'll just start my video. So when you remove the patch, you have suppose this is a patch. Okay, I remove it. This is a drug delivery surface, and there is no drug on this surface. When you take it out, just fold it like this, without touching this area. Take it, fold it. Okay, and then dispose it. Any other questions, Raju? So regarding the other medical management that I would prefer would be a dose of pretty good dose of steroid and maybe benzodiazepine to make her sleep comfortably. If the breathlessness is continuous, I assume that the breathlessness is continuous. So she may need a continuous infusion of benzodiazepine for her to be. Anything from Dr. Ann?
No, I was wondering what you plan to do about her bleeding. Is there anything that you're planning for her bleeding?
Mr. Chanagi, is there anything that's been done for her bleeding?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Vaginal bleeding is there, ma'am.
Okay. So is it controlled? Are you doing something for it?
Controlled, ma'am. It is controlled. Mm-hmm. And decreased, HP was decreased 7.5. 1 unit PRBC was already transfusion. Mm-hmm.
But the bleeding was decreased?
Decreased, ma'am.
Okay.
I think her concern, I'm sorry, who is Vito? Sister Janaki, sorry. Your concern about morphine and renal failure is very appropriate. That's correct. It's hard on patients when we give repeated doses of morphine to people in renal failure. So I think your response to use the fentanyl patch, which is handled well in kidney failure, was a good response. This would also be a case if your physicians are comfortable for methadone use, but I think you've handled this correctly. Do either of the teams know what to watch for morphine toxicity? How do you know if somebody has morphine toxicity? You can go ahead and restate that, Sri Devi, if you want to.
Yeah. So how will you understand the patient is on morphine toxicity? What are the signs or symptoms that you look for?
Mom, constipation was present, ma'am. Hello?
No, Janaki, I'm not asking about the side effect. Constipation will be there for all the patients, right? Most of the patients. So if the patient is having toxicity from morphine, what will you look for? How will you understand the patient is on morphine toxicity? Because usually then this is seen usually by the nurses. Before VC, usually the nurses see and tell us, okay, this is the time to reduce morphine. I think he's in toxicity. So what are the things? There are three things that you look for toxicity. That's another clue.
Respiratory depression is there? No.
Dilasa team, how will you look for toxicity? How will we understand whether the patient has toxicity?
Drowsiness.
Yes.
Or respiratory depression.
No.
And pinpoint pupils.
Yeah, maybe. Like, how will you identify that the first hand, maybe? Yeah, obviously the pupil size, everything will decrease on toxicity. Definitely, yes. That are the signs that you look for. Anything very simple that we always tell the patient?
Delirium.
Yeah, delirium.
Delirium.
What else? Somebody's answering in the background. I can't hear them. Show your face on the camera, who's ever answering.
Anyone behind Dilasa's laptop prompting? No? I think that is a noise from somewhere else.
Delirium, what else? I couldn't hear. So I think what Dr. Sri Devi is asking you to do is distinguish what is a side effect of morphine. We know those, right? Constipation, sedation, right? What else? Nausea, okay.
Nausea and vomiting.
Yeah, nausea and vomiting. Those are side effects. We want nurses to know, to be the first to notice if somebody has toxicity, too much morphine, and this happens because we accumulate metabolites of morphine. Any ideas? So you said delirium, that was one. You could look at the pupils, but that's not necessarily toxicity. And the third one, or important for me, is myoclonus. That's where... You see me? I'm doing it, I'm doing myoclonus for you. They do simple jerks. All right, so jerking motions that you think did I just see that? And then you look again and then you do it again. So that's called myoclonus or jerking. I mean, jerking is what it looks like. And the families will frequently tell you, I think the patient is having a seizure. I think they're having epilepsy. And you look at them and they're having myoclonus. Very important to watch for because it's easy to solve. They just need to get less morphine. Did I make myself clear?
Yes.
Sorry.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Goodbye.
Raju, did we exceed? Yeah. So this, what Dr. Ann pointed out is really important in terms of, because they, you see them, when you go to give medications, you may see them that jerky moments. You may see them talking irrelevantly. And you have to make sure, I mean, you have to relate that, oh, this can be due to overdose of morphine or patient may not need this much morphine. So why don't you all write two things to me before next week? What are the side effects of opioids? What are the toxic effects of opioids? And send it to Raj. I'll go through it. Because it's really important. Because we have talked about it, but it has repeated reading and writing. Because these things we cannot avoid when you're practicing palliative care. So just write. Even doctors get confused with all these. What are side effects? What are the toxic effects? Both are different. So just write a Word document or just send it to Raju, everyone. And those who are not participating today is also just write it in that email, Raju. Write about the side effects and toxic effects of. Thank you so much, everyone. And nice to see you. I couldn't hug you from here.
I don't have my long haircut today.
Oh, yeah.
That's why you didn't recognize me.
Thank you all for joining. And hope to
lovely
see you.
To meet you all.
Thank you, Dr. Sridevi, for that wonderful session. And thank you, Sister Janaki, for coming up with a very relevant patient story.
Yes, ma'am.
So we can see you on next Tuesday with a topic on psychosocial issues taken by Smriti ma'am. I have shared the feedback link. Give it a minute, do it, and then only leave the meeting. Thank you all for joining in. See you next week.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.